scholar for Young America's Foundation over the summer. We're pleased to have her with us today, so please join me in welcoming Grace.
Good morning, everyone. Please allow me to introduce to you Newt Gingrich, and welcome to Young America's Foundation's 39th National Conservative Student Conference. This conference is one of many programs the Foundation hosts for students across the country every year. Young America's Foundation is at the forefront of promoting conservative ideas on college campuses through its renowned campus lecture programs, hosting speakers such as Newt Gingrich, who you will hear from momentarily, and many others. Young America's Foundation is also credited with saving Rancho del Cielo, President Ronald Reagan's beloved ranch. There, students can learn from Ronald Reagan's values as the tenets of conservatism. And now allow me to introduce Newt Gingrich. Newt Gingrich is well known as the architect of the contract with America that led the Republican Party to victory in 1994 by capturing the majority in the U.S. House of Representatives for the first time in 40 years. After he was elected Speaker, he disrupted the status quo by moving power out of Washington and back to the American people. Under his leadership, Congress passed welfare reform, the first balanced budget in a generation, and the first tax cut in 16 years. In addition, the Congress restored funding to strengthen defense and intelligence capabilities, an action later lauded by the bipartisan 9/11 Commission. From May 2011 to May 2012, Newt Gingrich was a candidate for the Republican nomination for President of the United States, winning the South Carolina and the Georgia primaries. The campaign was especially notable for its innovative policy agenda, its effort to bring new coalitions into the Republican fold, and for Newt's debate performances. Gingrich was first elected to Congress in 1978, where he served the 6th District of Georgia for 20 years. In 1995, he was elected Speaker of the U.S. House of Representatives, where he served until 1999. The Washington Times has called him the indispensable leader, and Time magazine, in naming him Man of the Year for 1995, said, "Leaders make things possible. Exceptional leaders make them inevitable. Newt Gingrich belongs in the category of the exceptional." He received his bachelor's degree from Emory University and master's and doctorate in modern European history from Tulane University. Before his election to Congress, he taught history and environmental studies at West Georgia College for 8 years. Gingrich resides in McLean, Virginia with his wife, Callista Gingrich. Please join me in welcoming Speaker Newt Gingrich.
Thank you all very much, and I appreciate very much the Young America's Foundation allowing me to come and share some ideas with you. Let me, first of all, just explain. I had a nosebleed last Friday, and they had to cauterize a vein up in my nose. So now I have to have stuff in it. And so I decided I could either come and look stupid, or I could cancel. And I'm hoping that you thought it was better for me to come and look stupid. So anyway. But I'm a big fan of Young America's Foundation because I think it's very important that young conservatives have an opportunity to share ideas, to grow and to develop and to create the leadership of the future. And I'm delighted that you would take time out of your summer to come here and to be part of this. And I was thinking about exactly what to talk to you about. And it occurred to me, let me ask you a sort of a question, get your opinion. How many of you, think of this as a halftime report, okay? We're about 7 months into the Trump Republican House, Republican Senate system. How many of you think that it's been a successful first 7 months worth continuing on the same track? Okay. How many of you think that we have to have a dramatically better second half in getting legislation passed and in getting things done? Now I want to start there because Einstein once said that doing more of what you're already doing and expecting a different outcome is a sign of insanity. And I think it's really important to understand that there are some places where Trump has been very impactful. If you look at the first Supreme Court justice, just by itself, having a conservative justice instead of a liberal or radical justice may have justified the whole presidential campaign. But if you look at And if you look at deregulation, it has already been remarkable. And it's ironic that the New York Times and the Washington Post and the large networks can't bring themselves to cover it. But in fact, for example, they've been repealing 16 regulations for every new regulation. Now, they started out saying they wanted to do 2-for-1. They're at 16-to-1. One of the bills we passed when I was Speaker allows Congress to go back and review regulations passed in the last 6 months of an administration. And what people, I think, on the left didn't understand was if the Congress repeals the regulation and the president signs it, that then becomes law and you can't change it by executive order. So there are going to be about 3,300 pages of regulations that cannot be reimposed by executive order. You'd actually have to pass a law to reimpose them, and the odds are very high that the left will never be able to do it. So the estimate is already that the Trump system has saved billions and billions of dollars in private sector and local government and other regulatory costs by continuing to repeal it. So that's a zone I think they can claim some real success in. I think on immigration, if you look at the dramatic drop in the number of people crossing our southern border, there's been sort of a psychological wall built long before a physical wall, and it's had a direct impact. If you look at the job that Attorney General Sessions and others have done in picking up people on MS-13, which is the largest single organization of gangs in the U.S., it has been a remarkable shift in where we were to a new pattern. So there are things that are working well. The legislative side is not working as well, although in some areas, if you look, for example, at the Veterans Administration, they have now successfully passed on a bipartisan basis reform of the administration of the VA on a scale that nobody thought possible 3 years ago. And so you do see a different tone setting in. But on things like repealing Obamacare, they fell short. And I do two newsletters a week at Gingrich Productions. They're free if you want to go to Gingrich Productions and sign up for them. And the one that'll come out tomorrow is basically entitled 16-to-1. And I want to use this as a starting point of where we are. People were very angry at three Republicans for not voting yes. Now, in one case, Susan Collins, she has total integrity because she voted no back in the past. And she has consistently said she doesn't think it's possible to repeal Obamacare the way it is. The other two, Murkowski and McCain, said they were going to repeal Obamacare and then voted no. So people are really angry. The point of my article is to say there were 16 Democrats who voted no for each of the three Republicans. So the no vote was 48 Democrats and three Republicans. But because of the psychology of the Republican Party, we skip the 48 and focus on the three. Which, by the way, doesn't affect them at all because none of those three senators can be influenced. You can yell at them all week. Trust me, nothing that will happen in American politics is comparable to the years John McCain spent in a Vietnam prison camp. So trying to intimidate John McCain is just a dead loser. In Murkowski's case, she lost a primary. She won as an independent on a write-in vote. I mean, these are people who've been down. And in a sense, that's what you want. You want senators who are independent. You want senators who you have to convince you're right, not intimidate. And I think part of what happens to us sometimes is we get in a frenzy and we decide that everything we say about the Constitution and everything we say as conservatives is nice, but I want this one thing done. And then we get into sort of temper tantrum politics. If I don't get the one thing I want, I'm going to throw a temper tantrum. And I want to suggest to you a couple of observations. Some of this is in my newsletter coming out tomorrow. The Founding Fathers designed the Constitution to avoid dictatorship. They thought about this very long and very hard. And they were afraid that the mob would turn into a dictatorship, which is they'd studied particularly Greek history, where places like Athens had ultimately destroyed themselves by the rise of mobs. And so they consciously created a republic, not a democracy by plebiscite, because they wanted to slow down and calm down popular passion, and they wanted people to have to work their way through. And so they deliberately followed a theory by Montesquieu, a French theoretician, of division of power, or separation of power. So some power is in the Supreme Court, some power is in the House, which gets elected every 2 years, some power is in the Senate, which gets elected every 6 years, some power is in the White House, which gets elected every 4 years, and it's designed to have huge amounts of friction. So the Founding Fathers would say, we're designing a machine so inefficient that no dictator can make it work. Well, they were so brilliant at doing this that we can barely get it to work voluntarily. And so we get frustrated and we start yelling at each other. Now, I've been at this a very long time. My dad was a career soldier. And in August of 1958, while we were stationed in Europe, I decided that countries can die and that leadership matters. I'd actually been in France when the French Fourth Republic was killed by the paratroopers who came back from Algeria, and they brought Charles de Gaulle back. General de Gaulle came back and created the Fifth Republic, which still exists, the longest serving non-monarchy in French history. And I'd literally seen a government die while I was living in their country, a little bit of what you're seeing happen, for example, in Venezuela right now. And so I decided I would try to do three things. I would try to figure out, what does America have to do to survive? What does, how would you explain it to the American people so they would let you do it? And how would you implement it if they gave you permission? Because to take an idea, explain it so people say yes, you still have to implement it, or it's just an idea. So I've spent now since 1958 trying, on a very narrow track. I mean, it's been most of my life trying to understand those three things. And so I want to talk to you about that for a couple of minutes, because I am troubled by the lack of historical depth in our elected officials. It may be partly because we have too many lawyers, but I think it's very important to think about the history of how things operate. And I was very fortunate. I ran for Congress in 74 during Watergate, and I lost, got 48.5%. I came back and ran for Congress in Georgia with Jimmy Carter at the head of the Democratic ticket, and I lost in 76. I got 48.3%. And I came back and ran a third time with halfway through Carter's term, and I finally won. I came to Washington at a time when the Republican Party had not had control of the House for 24 years. And I said, being fairly simple-minded, wouldn't it be good if we had a plan to get to be a majority? And the head of the campaign committee, Congressman Vanderjack of Michigan, said, that is a great idea. Why don't you chair the committee? And so we created a committee to become a majority. Now, part of what I want to share with you, not to scare you off, but to just give you a feel for history. We worked actively almost every single day to become a majority. We lost in 80, 82, 84, 86, 88, 90, and 92. After 16 years, we won in 94 with the Contract with America. And we shocked everybody. I mean, the news media, if you go back and look at the video clips, as late as Monday night, they're saying, well, the Republicans will gain some seats, but of course, it's impossible for them to become a majority. And then we picked up 53 seats. We also picked up the Senate. We picked up governorships. And for the first time in 40 years, we became a majority. We then had to operate so that our base would decide we were doing the right thing, because the hardest election wasn't becoming a majority. We had done that in 1946 and 1952. We had not won re-election in the House as a majority since 1928. So we were trying to do something nobody had done in 68 years. And so we thought very long and very hard about how to do it. Now, as it turned out, once we won in 94, we kept the majority for 12 years. And we laid a big enough base that we came back after 4 years. So we went from a 40-year period where the Democrats controlled the House to us having now had control of the House vastly more than the Democrats since 1994. And if we can get through next year, we'll keep the House for a long time. So what I want to do for a couple of minutes is share with you a couple of lessons I learned over the years, because I was very fortunate. I came in just before Ronald Reagan won. I was part of the 78 and 80 campaigns where supply-side economics was developed. I worked with Jack Kemp and Jude Winiski and Art Laffer and others to develop supply-side economics and campaign. We convinced Reagan to run on tax cuts. And then I had the great opportunity to work with President Reagan for 8 years as a member of Congress. And much of what we did in the 90s in the Contract with America period was really standing on Reagan's shoulders. And so there are certain patterns. And for all of you who want to learn this business, it's important to remember that Ronald Reagan was an FDR Democrat. He was not a regular Republican. He was somebody who had voted for FDR. He actually cut a radio commercial for Hubert Humphrey running for the Senate in 1948, and he cut a commercial for Harry Truman. After 48, he became a Republican. But he had a long background of thinking like a Democrat. And that was important because the two parties were culturally very different. And it's still true. I mean, the Republican, part of the Republican weakness goes back to a pre-Reagan Republicanism that assumes it's a minority. Now, Reagan always assumed we were a majority. And think about it. If you think you're in the minority, and you've had this experience yourself in your own life, if you think you're in a minority, you sort of hunker down and you don't particularly think you can stand up to the other side because they're the majority. On the other hand, if you think you're the majority, then you're expansive and you're positive and you're outgoing and you're happy because, after all, you're a majority. So part of what Reagan did is he radiated a confidence of being the majority. And he had learned something. I'm going to give you a couple of reading assignments. In addition, I see a number of you have Understanding Trump, which, of course, should be the first book you read. You'll notice, by the way, it's not called Predicting Trump, because I don't think it's possible to predict Trump. I can't tell you what Trump will do tomorrow morning because Trump can't tell you what Trump will do tomorrow morning. But I think it is possible to understand him, and so that's probably why I wrote the book. And I do think he's a remarkable figure, and I do think that he is at least as big a change in the pattern of history as Reagan was, and maybe bigger. I think he in many ways resembles Andrew Jackson and is worth thinking of in terms of the level of disruption that Andrew Jackson made. In fact, I've always told people that Trump is one-third Andrew Jackson for disruption, one-third Theodore Roosevelt for energy, and one-third P.T. Barnum for salesmanship. And if you think of a blend of those three people, you begin to get some sense of how Trump operates. So I want you to think about a couple of core principles. First of all, one of the books you should get shortly after reading Understanding Trump is by Tom Evans, and it's called The Education of Ronald Reagan. Now, the reason it matters, it's a very small book, but the reason it matters is Evans goes back and looks at the 8 years that Reagan works for General Electric. And General Electric had a very sophisticated education program for their employees. And the reason was that they had seven unions. Two of them were communist and five of them were very, very left-wing. And they knew they couldn't negotiate with the leaders of the unions because they were hardcore, committed left-wingers. But they could educate the members about economic reality so that they would not vote for a strike. And so they built a very elaborate education program. And they wanted a happy, positive celebrity to be the front face of the program. So they hired Reagan, who was at the end of his movie career. And Reagan spent 8 years crisscrossing the country, giving speeches largely to blue-collar workers, taking questions, and then getting photo ops and having pictures with people. Reagan was in a period in his life where he wouldn't fly in an airplane. He'd had a really bad flight in 1946, and he did not fly again until 1965. So he always went by train. And so the guy who had hired him, the vice president of General Electric, was giving him all of these conservative economic books, things like Hayek and others. And so you have this image of Reagan riding around the country, reading conservative economic books while giving speeches to blue-collar workers and taking Q&A. So by the time he ran for governor, he'd already had 8 years of training. The key thing Reagan learned, which other Republicans have never learned, and it's the key also of the contract, is you have to move the American people. So look at this whole mess with Obamacare. For 7 months, the focus has been on the Congress. But in the end, the Congress isn't the key. The key is the American people. If we had spent as much time educating the American people and communicating with the American people and then writing a bill which reflected what the American people told us, we would have passed Obamacare's repeal with a bipartisan majority. Because people back home would have said, yeah, I want this new, better bill. We're going to face the same challenge with the upcoming tax cuts. the tax cuts have to be designed so they are understandable by the American people. And they have to be designed so the American people, upon understanding them, go, I want that. Now, if you write the right tax cut bill, then millions of people are going to go to their congressman and their senator, and they're going to say, I want you to vote for this bill. And I worked on this in 1981 with Reagan when he had his great tax cut, which was a huge tax cut. And it was pretty straightforward. We could go out and say to people, would you like more money in your pocket? And almost overwhelmingly, they said yes. We said, well, would you call your congressman or your senator and ask them to vote for this? We carried 1/3 of the Democrats in the House. Not because they had become Reaganites, not because they were ideologically conservative, but because they couldn't go back to town hall meetings and explain a no vote. So part of this thing we've got to remember, and the Republican Party has to learn, is power really does come from the people. That means you have to communicate with the people. The Reagan line was that his job was to shine the light on the American people so they would turn up the heat on Congress. And it was a very effective model. And so I think we have to have an attitude that we are going to explain what we're doing with such clarity that the American people want us to do it. Second, you need to develop what when I started this long journey, remember I said it took 16 years, you need to develop an attitude of cheerful persistence. Self-government is really hard. It is the hardest thing humans do other than fight a civil war. It's harder than running a business. It's harder than a regular war because self-government is this tumultuous, chaotic, very difficult process. And it always has been. Which means if you're going to be effective at it, you've got to adopt an attitude that it's okay, that it's frustrating. It's okay that we disagree with each other. Remember, this is a process by which 315 million people come together. They come all sorts of backgrounds, all sorts of interests, all sorts of ideologies, and they come together. And they don't necessarily agree. In many ways, it is a civil war fought with ballots rather than bullets, and fought with ideas rather than artillery. But it's a real conflict. People have really deep differences. You all know this on the campuses you're on. And so part of it is to just be cheerfully persistent. And if something doesn't work this week, you go, gee, I wonder what we should have learned. And you go back and try it again. Now, Reagan became an active anti-communist in 1946 because he was the head of the Screen Actors Guild. He's the president. And he went out and had drinks one evening with a guy who was a genuine Stalinist, who said to him, yes, not only am I a communist, but when we take over, we're either going to lock you up or shoot you. And Reagan went home and realized this guy was sincere. He was a genuine, hardcore communist. And so Reagan began studying, why did this guy believe this stuff? And the more he studied, the more anti-communist he became. Well, the Soviet Empire doesn't disappear until 1991. So for 45 years, Reagan was an active anti-communist. And there were periods when, frankly, it did not look like we were winning. But he just cheerfully gave speeches, talked about it, worked on it. Reagan proposes welfare reform in 1966, running for governor. We passed it 30 years later, 1996. The most successful single conservative reform of your lifetime. People went to work. Their salaries went up. More children left poverty in the last 4 years of the Clinton administration than any time in American history because their parents got jobs and did better. We just had the same experience in Maine where there was a reform for the SNAP card, and able-bodied adults that did not have children had to go to work. Of the 14,000 people who were on the program, 13,000 left the program, got a job, and their average income went up 116%. So these ideas come along, but it took 30 years. And as I think Governor Allen told you, you know, he was one of the pioneers in the early 90s implementing this. Governor Thompson of Wisconsin, Governor Leavitt in Utah, Governor Engler in Michigan. And then we brought them in once we took power. And collectively, we were able to write a very dramatic welfare reform bill based on their practical experience at the state level. So part of what you have to have is a sense of patience that over time, if you have the right ideas, you can get there. Now, your generation is going to have enormous opportunities. We're on the edge of a revolution in how you get into space. The rise of reusable vehicles by people like Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos is going to bring down the cost of going into space by at least a factor of 10 and maybe more. And nobody's thought about what does that mean in terms of, for example, your ability to be an astronaut. They won't even be astronauts at that point. You'll be passengers. And and I think they may start as early as next year or the year after, making it easy for normal, everyday people to start experiencing near space, and then a couple years later experiencing orbit, and then by the end of the 20s, going to Mars and going to the moon. This is a huge breakthrough, despite the government. It's not being done but driven by NASA. NASA, if anything, has hindered the process of getting there. You're going to see enormous breakthroughs in healthcare. Regenerative medicine, where we take your cells to grow what you need. So instead of kidney dialysis, you'll grow a new kidney. All of this stuff is coming down the road very, very rapidly and will be available. Breakthroughs in brain science, which will enable us to deal both with Alzheimer's and autism and Parkinson's, but also deal with schizophrenia and with other kind of mental illnesses. All of these things are about to happen. One of the tests is, can we rethink our education system so people learn the jobs of the future, they don't learn the jobs of the past? And can we avoid government regulation so we can keep inventing things? Remember, the Wright brothers, in the 5 years before they flew, had 500 failures. Think about that. I mean, imagine if they'd been a government program. After about failure number three, they'd have been fired. But they did it as a personal hobby. And because it was a personal hobby, they were cheap. The estimate was, this was in then-year dollars, but the estimate was that it cost them $1 per flight. So they would leave Dayton, Ohio, get on a train, go down to Kitty Hawk, which in North Carolina, which has the best uplift of wind in the United States. Something they learned, by the way, by going to the U.S. Weather Service. So the government did play a role. And they would try to figure out how to fly. And one of the things, the second thing I want you to read is an essay you can get if you Google it, called IYI, Intellectual Yet Idiot. It's actually in the book Understanding Trump, at the back of the book. It's by Nassim Taleb, who wrote The Black Swan. It's a very simple model. His argument is that at least 40% of the people who run government are intellectuals yet idiots, in the sense that they do really well at tests and they do really well at writing essays, but they don't know anything. So they could write a brilliant essay on how to change a tire, but if you had a flat tire, they'd have no clue how to actually change the tire. But the essay would read really well. And I think that's actually true, by the way. I think a lot of our problem today is we have people who sound really smart but don't know anything. So the Wright brothers, much like Donald Trump, and I'll tell you a story about Trump along the same line in just a minute, the Wright brothers had this simple model. They'd get up in the morning, they'd have coffee, they would try to fly. Now, they knew they weren't succeeding because they weren't flying. This is bold. This is out at the edge. They did not have some vast theoretical model. They didn't have some great apparatus. They just knew the plane wasn't flying. And they'd go back and they'd say, well, let's try something else. Finally, to show you how complicated and how this goes back to cheerful persistence, on December 17th, 1903, a Saturday, they get up in the morning, fix coffee. The first four times, they fail. The fifth time, it flies shorter than the wingspan of a Boeing 747 at a speed slow enough that one brother ran alongside it to make sure it didn't flip over and kill the other brother. But it had flown. And they understood the proof. They'd had proof of concept. 5 years later, they flew around the island of Manhattan for over an hour, and over 1.5 million people saw an airplane for the first time. Now, that's what an entrepreneurial society is like. And that's what we're at the edge of. And if we can avoid government, and by the way, part of government is lobbyists. I wrote a book a few years ago called Breakout, and the subtitle was Pioneers of the Future and Prison Guards of the Past. The number of places, for example, there's a new device which allows you to use your own computer to give yourself an eye exam. In almost every state, it's been outlawed by the lobbyists for the optometrists and the opticians, because they see it as a direct threat to, right now, if you want to get, I don't know how you wear contact lenses, but as a general rule, if you have to order new contact lenses, you have to go in for an eye exam to get them to then order you the new lenses. Now, the National Association says for professional reasons, you should do it every 2 years. But for practical reason of ordering your contacts, you do have to do it every year. This would replace half of those exams, and therefore would cut into the income of the optometrists and the opticians. And so they just have their lobbyists go and work the state legislature, and they outlaw it. It would be like the stagecoach having outlawed the airplane, because they wanted to make sure you had no competition. So this is a part of what your generation is going to face. The number of opportunities are going to be unbelievable. But as I said, in terms of IYI, you'll notice that the Wright brothers were very practical. They could tell they weren't flying, and they knew they had to change things. By the way, the Smithsonian got, remember I said they spent $500. The Smithsonian got a $50,000 grant from Congress, was so smart that they knew that they could build a really sophisticated airplane, got an extraordinarily powerful engine from Germany, adopted exactly the opposite strategy from the Wright brothers. The Wright brothers wanted the lightest possible engine, which allowed them to have the lightest possible frame, because they understood that the heavier you are, the harder it is to fly. Now, I know this is bold and out on the edge, but most of you, I'll bet, if I had said to you, do you think light or heavy works better, would have said light, if you're trying to fly. The Smithsonian gets a very powerful, remarkable engine with the most advanced metallurgy available in 1903. That means they've got to have a really heavy frame, or the engine will just tear it apart. So they then build an airplane that's really heavy. And then they are so confident in their arrogance that they decide they're not going to go to some faraway place like Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. They're going to take it right down here to Alexandria. They're going to put it on a boat, and they're going to launch it with a catapult, almost like the modern aircraft carriers, because they know it's going to fly the first time. Now, the Wright brothers failed 500 times. Now, the number one characteristic, if you launch an airplane from a boat, is if it doesn't fly, where does it go? It goes in the river, which means you have no idea what didn't work because the current of the river tore the plane apart. So, being confident in their arrogance, they invited the news media to come and cover this first flight. And you can read the articles. The Smithsonian was so angry at the Wright brothers for having invented flight that the Wright brothers did not give them the airplane, which is now in the Air and Space Museum, until 1937. Because the Smithsonian was just enraged. I mean, how could they didn't have a PhD, they didn't have a government grant, they didn't represent official bureaucracy. They were just two bicycle mechanics who were smart. How dare they invent the future? And that's one of the challenges for your generation, is to go back and realize when you're dealing with somebody who's an intellectual yet idiot, don't pay them respect. Don't be intimidated. I would argue that the Congressional Budget Office is the perfect manifestation in Washington of intellectual yet idiot. It is, I'm writing a paper on this right now called Meganomics, and the deep state economic establishment. I mean, they are dedicated to models that don't work, and they are consistently wrong. And yet powerful politicians and powerful news media will say, the independent Congressional Budget Office. Now, if they said the independent but unbelievably stupid, I would understand it, because they're consistently wrong. Instead, the Congress allows the Congressional Budget Office to do the scoring, which tells the Congress what they're allowed to do, even though they know the scoring is stupid. Now, this is an example of intellectual yet idiot at work. And it goes on every week in the city. Now, let me give you one of the reasons I decided I really like Trump is the Woolman Skating Rink. Have any of you ever been there, by the way? It's in New York. It's in Central Park. No one? The woman, well, the hand went like this. Okay. That's the yes, I was there, but I don't want people to know who I am. So the woman skating rink in 1980 broke. Now, in the tradition of IYI, intellectual yet idiot, we knew it broke because it couldn't make ice. And a skating rink with no ice is pretty stupid. I'm right out on the edge here. This is why people think I'm a radical. I do have a PhD. I could use bigger words, but like Trump, I think being clear and plain is useful. So for 6 years, the city of New York tried to fix the Woolman Rink. They spent $13 million in 6 years. They went to a firm in Florida that had a stunningly elegant, environmentally perfect, remarkably advanced system, whose only disadvantage was it didn't work. And Trump, whose apartment looks out over Central Park, finally got pissed off. And he began making fun of Mayor Koch in the news media. You know, you can't make ice in an ice skating rink? So finally, Koch got really angry. This is all a chapter in his book. It's covered in Understanding Trump, but it's a long chapter in his book on the art of the deal. And so Koch says, all right, we're going to give you $3 million and 6 months. You're so smart, fix it. Now, the reason I decided I was really intrigued with Trump is the next part of the chapter. He says, now that the mayor had challenged me, I realized I had to get it fixed or he was going to humiliate me in public. And I realized I didn't know anything about fixing ice rinks. So I thought to myself, who does ice rinks? And I thought, Canadians. I mean, I love this. I love this idea. This guy spends months making fun of the mayor and the news media, has no idea what he's going to do. And then he applies common sense, right? And so he said, find me the firm that makes the National Hockey League ice skating rinks, because they probably know what they're doing. They fly in from Canada. They go look at the rink. They come to see him, and they say, this is so stupid, it's embarrassing. They fix it in 3 months for $2.5 million. Take the extra $500,000, put it in a trust fund and the rink today, which, of course, becomes the Trump-Woolman skating rink, or Woolman-Trump, maybe it is. But, of course, he has to put his name on. But he fixes it, right? I mean, look, if you can fix it, I'm for you. Well, what I liked about the story is, first of all, the obviousness. It's broken. Second, the common sense. Go to somebody who knows what they're doing. And go wherever they are. So he brings in Canadians. And it turns out they knew what they were doing. So if you can go through life and take the cheerful persistence and common sense of the Wright brothers and the cheerful persistence and common sense of Trump and apply that attitude, you will lead to a revolution. We will cut through so much red tape, so much, I mean, think about how many courses you take that in all honesty you know are being taught by an intellectual yet idiot. I mean, how many of you have had at least one professor who fits that model? I won't ask you to name any names because, you know. So, I believe we're at the edge of a great, extraordinary explosion of energy. I believe we are likely to be the most dynamic country in the world once again. I think that despite some of the confusion, that I think Trump actually is the right person because he is breaking up the norm. And I would much rather have somebody who occasionally does really stupid tweets but is breaking up the norm than have somebody who's elegant and smooth, but doesn't have a clue. So I did. I got in a little bit of trouble, by the way, because, you know, Hillary Clinton's going to write this book, which I think is called, like, What Happened? Is it What Happened? Right? And I tweeted the other day, my close friend and attorney, Randy Evans, is the guy who came up with the idea of having a book called Understanding Trump. And he called me one day in December and said, you've got to write Understanding Trump. He said, nobody understands Trump, and just the title will sell the book. Later on, we decided we'd actually do a book to put inside the title, but still. So he called me the other day and he said, you have to tweet that you're going to write Understanding What Happened. Now, I'm going to get this wrong, but there's a phrase, it's not man-speak. What is the phrase when men... Mansplain, yeah. So I suddenly get these tweets suggesting that this is an example of mansplaining, okay? And I didn't understand it, A, because I'm too old for a lot of this stuff. I mean, I go to campuses, I say I'm going to commit a macroaggression. And I'll just get it over with at phase one. And I usually say things like, ISIS wants to cut off your head. Now, if you can get over that, we'll talk later about microaggressions. But it occurred to me, there's something profoundly wrong about that model. I am not suggesting that Hillary Clinton does not understand what happened because she's a female. I'm suggesting that Hillary Clinton does not understand what happened because she's a unique human being who has rejected reality her entire life, and who... And I'm actually about to teach a series of courses we're going to put online about the whole idea of defending America against really stupid left-wing ideas. And I think this is an example. I mean, I've spent my whole life surrounded by women. In fact, I went on The View one day and I said, this is just normal. I mean, there were all these women and me. Well, my aunts were around, my mother, my grandmother. My whole life has been like that. My two daughters. Nobody's ever talked about woman-splaining. I don't understand what mansplaining is, why we can't have woman-splaining to go along with mansplaining. But in this particular case, it has nothing to do with her sex. It has to do with the fact that she doesn't get it, that as a unique human being, I'm treasuring her as a unique human being, okay? I'm saying that this is not since Al Gore have we seen somebody who is this out of touch with reality. And it's not me. You should, if you've not read it, I'm going to two last books and then I'm going to take questions. There's a terrific book called Shattered, which is written by these two liberal reporters who'd clearly gotten a contract to cover the Clinton campaign and explain how she shattered the glass ceiling, right? Well, they're sitting there election night, and this is, by the way, part of why the left is so crazy. Because at 8 o'clock on election night, they were going to win, get a left-wing court, continue to impose radical values, everything would be fine. And at 11 o'clock that night, they had Donald J. Trump. And the whiplash of that three-hour change was so enormous that most of them have not recovered. I mean, they're still crazed. And they're still wandering around going, this can't be true. And every time Trump tweets something, they twitch. And they get up in the morning and they go, oh, my God, he's still president. I cannot take this anymore. So these two reporters were quite clever. And they realized about 11 o'clock at night that they better write a new book. Because the book about how she shattered the glass ceiling wasn't going to work. So they wrote a book about why did she lose. It's a brilliant book. And by the way, it says that by the day after the election, she had come up with the reason she'd lost. It was Comey's press conferences and the Russians. And of course, all of her senior staff, who were the people who lost the election, are all gone. That's right. That's right. Oh, yeah, that was them. Yeah, they did it. I mean, you should be really mad at them because they did it. Because it wasn't us who you paid a lot of money, even though we're idiots, but they did it. But it's a fascinating book, which I recommend. And so I'm looking forward to Hillary. I think this is a mistake for her to try to write a book to explain what happened, because it's either going to come across as whiny or really angry. But it's not going to come across as a calm, dispassionate, I grew up very young and I never did quite get it. And Bill always had me confused. And if Obama hadn't been president first, then I would have been president, but he beat me. And ever since I got beat in 08, I've never quite recovered. It's her version of, 27-step program or something. Anyway, but how many of you would be intrigued by a book called Understanding What Happened? Okay, now the other option I've got, though, is I'm thinking about writing a book called Understanding the Swamp. What do you all think of that? Is that a better title? Can I have at least one chapter on Hillary? I mean, at this thing. I can't resist. I just, it's, maybe I'll do a chapter on Hillary and Al, and split the chapter. You know. Anyway, last book. There is a remarkable small book by Claire Berlinski, City of Berlin with an SKI after it. She's an American novelist. It is called There Is No Alternative, Why Margaret Thatcher Matters. And I recommend it to you. It is an astonishing book. Trump is more Thatcher than Reagan. The reason the left hates him is they understand he is a mortal threat to everything they value. Reagan was not. Reagan was a huge threat to communism in Moscow, but he was no threat to communism at Stanford. So the left could dislike Reagan, but they didn't have to hate him. But Trump is really a mortal threat to the left. Not because he's a hardline conservative, but because he's anti-politically correct, he's anti-left, he's anti-stupid, and he's deeply, I know they're sort of synonyms, and he is deeply passionately pro-American. And if you're a true left-winger, you just start twitching when somebody's passionately pro-American, because you know that it's only one step away from a fascist dictatorship. And if you actually, if you actually like the American flag, who knows what other weird values you might have. So that's a sweeping overview. I think we can take questions if anybody wants to.
Good morning, Speaker Gingrich. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Caroline Lindy. I'm a rising freshman at Hillsdale College, and I've actually read that book by Mr. Thomas Evans on the education of Reagan. I know in the book, it said that Reagan saw his time at GE as his apprenticeship for the presidency, and the author attributes Mr. Boulware to a lot of the education of Reagan at that time. Do you see a Boulware in the present day who's not only educating leaders like Trump, President Trump, but also the common workers, the blue class men and women who need that basic education of economics?
No, I actually don't. I mean, I think it's a good point. There almost ought to be an institute led by the Chamber of Commerce or somebody. Boulware was the vice president for employee relations at General Electric. He developed a model called Boulwareism. And it's a remarkable story. But that's one of our great weaknesses today, is we don't teach the basics. People don't learn the basics. And probably, if we did have a Boulware, it would have to be on social media.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Sarah Montgomery. I go to the University of Georgia. And actually, when I'm not going to University of Georgia, I live in Georgia 6th, so from my district. My question was, so you spoke about how Trump is very effective in the private sector, and somehow you think that translates to him being effective in the public sector, but you've also acknowledged that there's a difference between the public and the private sector, given that the public sector is by necessity and by design slow and inefficient. So why do you think someone from the public sector can change the inherent design of the public sector?
Well, that's a very good question. I would draw a real distinction. I think there are three parts to that. The first is, and this is one where I think Trump has not learned as fast as I thought he would, the whole process of dealing with the legislative branch, which is by design cumbersome and difficult, and where they have real power. I mean, they don't work for Trump. They may decide to work with Trump, but they're independently elected. And I think there he's had a challenge because it didn't fit his models. I think a second role of the president, though, is the bully pulpit, as Theodore Roosevelt called it, and there I think Trump has had an impact. I think if you look at consumer confidence, if you look at CEO confidence, you look at a whole range of things, people are beginning to function a little differently than they did in the Obama era. I think in the third area, you can have executive branch agencies that are very fast and very effective. They usually have to be smaller than they currently are. But at their peak, whether it's the air traffic control system or the Federal Bureau of Investigation or special forces in the military, we do on occasion have systems that are very, very effective. That requires real management and real drive. And in the current era, it requires profoundly changing the regulatory problems that inhibit our ability to manage the government. But I think Trump probably, given the quality of his cabinet, which is really quite remarkable, I mean, if you look at his total cabinet, it may be the most competent since Eisenhower. And so I think they are having an effect. Shulkin, for example, at the VA, Veterans Administration, is having a real effect. And I think you're going to find in a lot of places, Perry at Energy, Zinke at Interior, these are really competent people.
Hello, Mr. Speaker. My name is Saurabh Sharma from the University of Texas at Austin. And I had a question about civility in politics for you. Before this conference, I was looking, and you can fill a library with the amount of academic literature on how you apparently destroyed civility in politics. There's tons of thousands of books on it. And I was just curious as to your opinion. Are we really living in a more uncivil time, both at the legislative level and at the personal level, or is it just the media wandering about trying to find narratives?
Well, no. I mean, first of all, the academics who believe I destroyed civility are almost all Democrats who thought it was deeply inappropriate that we won. Because they thought it was perfectly civil if Tip O'Neill's speaker said that Ronald Reagan had ice water in his veins. That was a sign of civility because, after all, he's a good Irish guy and couldn't possibly be negative. Second, I try to remind everybody, Hamilton is about the Vice President of the United States shooting the Secretary of the Treasury. Now, that's uncivil. But we have not had a major cabinet officer shot by the Vice President in modern times. So when people say to me, oh, civility is really declining, compared to what? Third, I'll bet 90% of you talk privately with a vulgarity which your grandparents would be stunned by. Because it's the common culture. I mean, we live in the age of the Kardashians. And so this is part of why Trump won. I mean, Trump was the one guy on stage who got it. It didn't matter how much of a thug he was. This was reality TV. And people had decided they were used to reality TV, and this became a version of Survivor. You know, I was once asked by Bill O'Reilly why the Republican candidates weren't attacking Trump when he was the front runner. And I said, look, Trump is like the grizzly bear in The Revenant. You get him awake, he comes over, he bites off your face, he sits on you for a while. Everybody else stares and goes, not me, no, 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 no. You know. I talk about this a little bit in understanding Trump. He brilliantly understood that instead of attacking, he would brand. So his most dangerous opponent at the beginning of the cycle was Jeb Bush, who raised $108 million. And he figured out that the right way to branding always has to involve something which is fundamentally true. Whereas attacking doesn't have to involve anything that's true, just you can smear people. But branding doesn't work with a smear. So he turned and he said, you know, I'm really worried about Jeb. I mean, he's so low energy. And all of a sudden, that fit what people were watching. And by the third or fourth debate, Jeb was running in New Hampshire. Now, I mean, physically running in New Hampshire. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever been to New Hampshire, but New Hampshire is not a state where people grow up thinking, yes, what I want is a commander-in-chief who puts on his running shorts and runs through my town to prove that he's high energy. And people just thought it was weird. I mean, you know. So I think when you talk about civility, Watergate occurred before I was a national figure. It wasn't very civil. People chanted lots of nasty things during the anti-war movement. Wasn't particularly, I mean, you know, watch Forrest Gump. You know, so anyway, okay?
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Hello, Mr. Speaker. My name is Benjamin Schrader from Texas A&M University. And I wanted to ask you a really simple question. What inspired you to get involved in politics?
Terror. Look, watch what's happening right now in Venezuela. Look what's happening in Syria. All it takes is a generation of truly incompetent politicians to destroy your country. And when I was a kid, I watched the French Fourth Republic collapse. I watched the Cold War with the Soviets, which was very real. And I thought, you know, a handful of people have to spend their lifetime trying to figure out how to survive. And so I did it as an act of duty. I was going to be either a vertebrate paleontologist or a zoo director. But I really did come to a conclusion that this is so real. And nothing I've seen in my lifetime has convinced me otherwise. I mean, if you watch the remarkable collapse of Venezuela and the human pain involved, or the remarkable collapse of Syria, you have to think you need the kind of leadership that can avoid that.
Hi, Mr. Speaker. I'm Jamie Hahn from Kennesaw State University, and my question has to do with Reagan's ability to move people. Largely, that was because of his, because he was so well-known already. So how would you suggest being able to move an apathetic student body of your peers?
Oh, I think a student body.
Yeah.
I'd say two things: cheerful persistence. You try something out. If it doesn't work, try something else. And making lots of noise. Large part of my career was a function of being sufficiently outrageous that people noticed me. And again, I mean, Trump is a perfect example. This is a guy who was so noisy in the 80s that by 1989, he was on the cover of Time magazine, and Oprah was asking if he's going to run for president. And Trump, and he describes this. He wrote two really good books. One is The Art of the Deal, which he wrote as a young man on the way up in the 80s. And the other is The Art of the Comeback, which he wrote in the 90s after he almost went broke. And they're both interesting. The Art of the Comeback is in some ways psychologically more revealing. But one of the points he makes is that the sheer noise matters. When he first decided that they were going to build, I think it was Trump Tower, they were taking down an old, smaller building. And it had two really interesting Art Deco pieces on the front of the building, which he wanted to give, announced he wanted to give to the Metropolitan Museum of Art. But the lawyer, the engineers then came in and said to him, that's going to cost you $500,000. And back then he didn't have very much money, he was just starting his career. And so he decided then just take him down, destroy him. At which point the New York media went crazy. You know, Trump breaks his word. But in every article they said, while building his fabulous new extraordinary building, and he said he realized after a couple of weeks, all the negative publicity was driving home the fact that Trump Tower was going to be a great building. And so he was quite comfortable with it. If you watch Trump, he operates on a theory of sheer noise. And I would argue that the same thing's true in your school. So you use social media, you use Twitter, you use Facebook, you find a variety of Snapchat, I mean, you find a variety of ways of communicating. And by brute repetition, you build a following. And one morning you must be somebody because enough people are following you. They wouldn't be following you if you weren't somebody. So therefore, you are somebody, even if you aren't anybody. And welcome to modern America. Thank you all very, very much.
Let's have another round of applause for Speaker Gingrich. All right, well, my name is Grant Strobel. I'm the National Chairman of Young Americans for Freedom. And I'll talk more about Young Americans for Freedom in a moment, perhaps this afternoon or tomorrow. But first, I want to introduce our sponsor of the day, Elena Richardson. Elena Richardson is the director of the Young Leaders Program at the Heritage Foundation. I am actually a graduate of the Young Leaders Program just recently.